Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Screen Junkies Movie Fights, powered by the Schmoes No Network. Now your host, Andy Signor.
Hello, Screen Junkies. Welcome to Movie Fights. It has been a big week of some fun, exciting stuff that we are here to battle. I want to welcome, again, if you don't know what the show is, it's where real nerds get in real fights over fake movies. Spencer, you wrote that. That was funny. That was a good tagline.
Yeah.
So we piled through the big week in the news. Upcoming, we have some big... the one that obviously came in last minute was the Star Wars title. We had to call that out. We're going to fight over, do we like the Episode 7 title? But our big bout this week is going to be Interstellar. Did it suck? We have some panelists who felt that it did, and some that didn't, who loved it. We will break it down. Also, we're going to talk best movie trilogy and a bunch of other fun stuff, so stick around. Toy Story 4, a lot of fun stuff, so keep tuned.
No Marvel stuff. No Marvel stuff.
No Marvel stuff. This week. We're actually going to...
first.
Yeah. I don't want to tell them. Now they're going to be like, oh, well, crap, I'm not going to watch this show. Please watch the show. We got a lot of fun stuff coming.
We'll work it out.
And in fact, if you don't like a battle, you can click the bottom right of the screen on YouTube, and you can actually zoom through all the fights. So if you don't like a battle, go to the next one. That's how fun the show is. So I'd like to bring in this week's Gladiators. First, I just want to thank big news. We're now part of the Popcorn Talk Network. That's brought to you by Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergo over here. They actually helped put this show together a lot. So we'll talk a little bit more at the end, and there's links in the description below. But they work in conjunction with the Schmoes, and they're who house this place, and I want to thank them. Please check out their other shows. We're going to talk about it at the end. Again, click the links in the description. But thanks, guys, and more excited to be part of this Popcorn Talk Network program. It's going to be awesome. Lots of fun stuff coming. Before we get to our battles, I want to quickly introduce who we got here fighting. Up first, you know him, you love him, I hope. Yeah. He writes all the funny, honest trailers that you all do know and love. So welcome, Spencer Gilbert.
Yeah, hey guys. Thanks for having me back, Andy, and keep watching honest trailers.
Next to him, we just had him on the show this week, and he was so great. We brought him right back. Roger Barr, he from iMockery, thank you so much for coming. And also the fantastic game, Abobo's Big Adventure. What an awesome, Double Dragon good. Character.
Yes.
Yeah, the classic mini boss from Double Dragon. It's just him beating the crap out of every Nintendo character you can think of. Yeah.
This is how you're spending your weekend, is playing that game.
Yeah, pretty much.
We are excited to have you. And next to him, he's been gone a couple weeks. He was on the bench. We brought him back in. It's Nick Mundy.
Hey, guys. Woo! Well, glad to be back, ready to start some fights.
Heard you had some tweets with The Rock this week.
Yeah, we're friends. Friends tweeted
it's
each
legit.
Other. Friends
it's legit. Tweeted he's, not make, he's not making it up. It.
Yeah. He announced that Shazam is not going to be a part of the regular DC universe. It's going to be its own thing. He
well, really? That's not on our schedule today, but that's fascinating.
But Nick Mundy's Twitter is breaking news, so give it a follow.
So follow Dick Fundy. All right, great. So as you guys know, I'll declare a winner each end of the round. I want you guys to be passionate. I want you guys to be fun. I want you guys to be smart. We're not being mean here, even if Nick tries to get you there. It's a passionate discussion. Let's get to it. In the great words of Ken Watanabe,
let them fight.
Yes. That's never going away.
All that movie's
no matter
good
how
for.
Much they complain.
That's all that movie's good for.
So, first up, we got to go to the big news that announced really recently. Star Wars Episode 7, the title came out. It is called The Force Awakens. Now, so that brings us to round one. Do we like the Star Wars Episode 7 title? What would you have wanted to call it? So we're going to start with you, Spencer. The Force Awakens. Did it awaken your excitement?
It did. I mean, the bar has been set so low for Star Wars. Do you guys remember having to talk yourself into Attack of the Clones? Like, well, you know, it's got Attack in it. It might be exciting.
No, because I was one of those guys who was like, no, it'll be better. It'll be better. I swear it'll be better. It'll be, yeah. No,
but I feel like we're all still in that mindset of us as a species just being like, please don't suck. Please don't suck. Please don't suck. And while this doesn't make me say it's going to be great, it doesn't make me say it's going to be terrible. It's fine.
Yeah,
it's...
I camped out for that first prequel.
Me too.
I don't think I'll do that for this one.
I will.
You will? Okay. All right.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, it gives us maybe a clue of to what it's about, that the Force is awakening. We know Luke Skywalker's still around with the Force, so... who has it? Who's it awakening in? So it might give us a nice nod towards what the movie's about. And I think it's like a subtle dig at the prequels that they put the franchise into a coma and we're now finally waking up from that fever dream.
It also really just like craps all over the extended universe, which is fine. Even though that's how I spent my high school years
reading
those
books.
Roger, let's hear your opinion before we get to Nick's. Like it or not?
I'm not a big fan of it, honestly. It's okay, but it's more like, you know, all right, The Force Awakens. Was it asleep this whole time? The only thing I guess I can get out of that is maybe, you know, the Force went to sleep because of the prequels, and now they're waking it back up. That's kind of what they're saying. So, I mean, I would have liked something a little more interesting.
And you're not on board with that? They're bringing the Force back.
again, like I guess I try to think like the prequels didn't happen, and also, so the Force has been with us the whole time.
Yeah, but you're a game guy. Force Unleashed. That was a fun game.
Yeah, it was a fun game.
Yeah, it kind of sounds like that.
Yeah, all right.
That's a stretch.
that's a big stretch.
Nick?
Yeah. I don't think it matters at all. Like, it really doesn't. Like, I'm glad it's not like Star Wars Episode 8, The Awakening Quagmire. Like, I mean, it's just like, but like, JJ wants to go to, like, back to the basics. They should have just called it Star Wars. Just call it Star Wars. Treat it like, you know, a Weezer album or like the Metallica's Black album. Let the people call it Episode 7 or whatever. Just call it Star Wars. We don't need some silly title. Like, you're
no, I'd love a silly title. Like, no. Yoda Man Now, dog. No, but like, but like, I'm yeah. fine with that.
On the other hand, it could have been
Keep Star your Hans Wars. To yourself. Yeah,
it could have been Star
like
Wars,
be
colon, I Hate America, and I'm still going to watch it. Mm. Like, it's still going to be, like, it's Star Wars. It doesn't matter what it's called.
Guys,
like,
do you agree? Does it need a subtitle?
Yeah, it does, because just does. Star Wars makes it sound like a reboot, and the last thing we want right. is for this to be a gritty reboot of Star Wars, even though it probably will be.
No,
we want it to be a continuation of the ones we liked. And yeah, but Episode 7 would have gone along.
Yeah, and a lot of people were complaining online that Disney didn't have those Roman numerals in the title.
But those were added in the 90s. Who cares? I mean, this is when Lucas was on his fever dream of like, let's ruin the movies because everyone loves them. Mm-hmm. And like, let's start, like, all of a sudden Star Wars is A New Hope and Episode 4. It's like, when did that happen?
Look, I need the episode number so I know which goddamn movie I'm watching.
What order do I watch it in?
Yeah, I know. It's like, no, but that's the point. Those Roman numerals are for the dummies who are going to watch it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, instead of the way you're supposed to watch it, 4, 5, 6,
2,
and then not ending.
Yeah.
But it's interesting. I mean, Star Trek did that. J.J. Abrams didn't give a subtitle to the Star Trek reboot, which in theory was
in
the same
canon. But that was a reboot.
That was a reboot. Yeah. I mean, to be fair.
A different time stream or whatever you want
to call
it. But
that's
not the beginning of it.
I'd be fine if they called it Star Wars The Final Frontier, honestly. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd be fine if they called it Star Trek or Guardians of the Galaxy 2. Yeah. I mean, it's going to be a good J.J. Abrams movie.
I don't think the title matters. It really doesn't. I mean, The Force Awakens, sure, that's benign. We don't care. Like, we just want to watch it.
Benign is an improvement at this point. I'll take it.
No, I know. Definitely.
Subtitle. It needs a subtitle.
All right, I'm going to call it. I mean, I think we're all excited still, it sounds like. We're going to give it a shot. But I think I don't agree with you, Nick, in that I think it does need the subtitle. There's too many of them. You need something. But I agree they're just going to call it Star Wars. It's going to work its own that way. And I loved it does need the silly title. I gave you points for that. But I give the point benefit to Spencer here. He wins the round. It's because you made the coma joke first. It was strong. And we don't want it to be mistaken for a reboot. We want it to be part of the place.
Though
it could be called Guardians 2. So at the end of the day, I'm giving Spencer the win on that round. We are excited, though. Yes, we all want to see this
movie.
Hell
yeah.
We want to see it, absolutely.
And then we'll be disappointed.
I can't be after the prequels. I can't be disappointed.
What would you guys have
really
won? I mean, did either of you guys have actually any actual titles that you could pitch that you would have preferred it be called?
Like a serious one?
Yeah.
No.
Not the Gungan Senate, as we called it in Screen Junkie Show?
I just said
with
I want
Star
as long
Wars.
As it's not like Star Wars Reloaded,
that
would be fun.
I just wanted Star Wars, so why would I have another title?
Got it.
Andy, may I interject?
Oh, I'm sorry. I never even told the audience this. We have Dan Merle here on the Dan Cam. He's going to fact check some stuff to hear. Hey, Dan.
Hi, how are you? I hope you can hear me because I can't hear you.
We can hear you.
Okay, great. Yeah. Two things. First of all, Nick, the subtitles were added in 1981. It was the first time Star Wars got the Episode 4 subtitle.
Oh, so he loses a point. Good.
Yeah, he's negative points now.
Empire Strikes Back was the first
YouTube
movie to have
Dan Merle, everyone.
an actual Roman numeral. And Andy used at the end of the day, so you get...
Oh,
you get your first buzzer of the
day. I did. We are well aware that I used that phrase too much, but at the end of the day, I'm going to keep doing it.
I feel like we're on CinemaSin.
Are we allowed to throw
Thanks for that,
in?
Dan.
Of course. Thanks for ruining the fun.
That's what I'm here for.
So one negative point to Nick and a point positive point to Spencer.
The first action figure on the table that falls over, that's the one we throw at him.
Yes, sir.
Well, Captain America's down.
We're going to move.
All right.
We're moving right into round two.
I'm going to throw my comms
this
at
is Dan. A fan question from Tyler Myers on Twitter. You can tweet us all these questions at Screen Junkies on Twitter. Does Interstellar live up to the hype? Great question. We got to see it this week, obviously. We saw it early. We've been stewing on it. A lot of us have opinions on it. I know it feels like it's been pretty divisive in the community as well. It's a love or hate type of movie.
It is.
I'm very excited to do this debate. I want to get to all your thoughts. Let's start with you.
Can we start with a spoiler alert?
Oh, just for thank you. Yes.
The movie
yeah, so if you
point.
Haven't seen the movie, you might want to skip to the next battle. Probably skip ahead 5-6 minutes if you're on the iTunes. But yes, we will be talking spoilers. Thank you for making sure I said that. So let's start with you, Roger. What did you think of Interstellar? Did you love it? Did you hate it?
I absolutely loved it. And this is one of those movies you have to see on the big screen. I mean, it is meant... This is not something you load up on your phone and watch it or watch it on YouTube or something later on. You need to see this in the theater. It's so ambitious what Christopher Nolan and all them did. I cannot wait to see it again, honestly. He took us places that we haven't been before in a space movie, I thought. And I know a lot of people are divided on that, and they don't like, you know, there's love story in it and all that. But that's part of Christopher Nolan's movies. I mean, he wants to explore all the aspects of human emotion. He's taking us to space and showing you, you know, what it's like. You know, not only are you going on this daring, risky adventure, but you're also leaving your families behind and everything. And I can see you gritting your teeth right there.
It's weird that he wants to take us through all these human emotions when he doesn't really understand them.
Even
Nick, go ahead. So you didn't like the movie, I take it.
I did not care for this movie in any way. Like, yeah, sure, it's a visual masterpiece, and it's beautiful to look at. And sure, he's trying to show that, like the fundamental laws of physics and love. Great, but it's a bad movie. It's basically a 90s disaster movie, like Armageddon, like Deep Impact, like The Core. It's just less fun and way more highbrow.
Are you reading a script?
Huh?
Are you reading a script?
I have notes. I have notes. But it's also, it doesn't
speak from the heart, Dan.
It doesn't have the decency of an Aerosmith song. It's just sloppily put together and just way completely incoherent. First off, it's the most convenient movie.
It's too highbrow. I'd rather watch Need
Nick,
for Speed.
Close the computer, Nick.
Okay.
I want to hear from the heart.
It is the most convenient movie I've ever seen in my life. Like, okay, what if Matthew McConaughey didn't find NASA? What was NASA going to do? He's the best pilot for him. They didn't even
look
for him.
They had people in the simulator. Yeah.
At least in Armageddon, they went to go get the oil guys and his dirtbag friends. They went to do it. What if, like, McConaughey's daughter, Murph, wasn't a super genius?
I feel like we really are at SimaSins.
They explain that in the movie. She was chosen.
We can break down the points if we have to, but overall you said no. Spencer, I want to get your thoughts so we can start this fight.
I also said no, and I just have to read for 1 second because I had to try to get the plot straight in my own head. And from what I recall, it's a movie about a girl whose dad flies into a black hole and through the power of love travels back in time to his daughter's bedroom to haunt an old wristwatch so that it taps out the secrets to the universe in Morse code. Mm-hmm. Now that happens. We can't pretend that didn't happen.
That absolutely happens. Yeah.
Roger, thoughts on that?
No, I liked it. I actually liked it. So look, we're going into this wormhole and stuff, but it's also just when you're in that wormhole and you're seeing like all these different it's different points in time of like the daughter in like in the bedroom with the library and all that. That looked incredible.
I will concede that this was a visually incredible movie and it was ambitious.
Can someone explain the wormhole to me?
The wormhole or the black hole?
No, but you can't. No one can explain it because Nolan doesn't like explaining things. Like,
well, he likes exposition.
I feel like he did explain a lot, but I'm being,
he doesn't explain like why Casey Affleck is all of a sudden fighting with his sister and they won't take care of the family. Like, Nolan's like, you know what? We don't need this scene. People have seen movies. We don't need to explain.
Yeah, I forgot
to
add, while he's tapping out the secrets on the wristwatch, his son and her brother is driving back in a truck to maybe kill her and Topher Grace because they tried to cure his daughter's black lung.
And they didn't explain.
That also happened.
And they didn't explain why everyone was leaving. Like, what is happening? What is the...
They're like, running out of food.
Right.
Yeah, okay, no, but did something else happen to why now everyone's getting the hell out of that?
We can explain that. Corn was the only food left.
Right, and all that disease was spreading and they couldn't make it anymore.
Did she burn the food source?
Yes.
She burned it
so they would leave the farm.
And then why was Casey Affleck a psychopath all of a sudden?
We're getting bogged down in specifics, though, because we could pick any movie that deals with time travel and outer space apart. But in general, this was just like... We have a problem. It's impossible. I'm going to do it because we got to save Murph. And you just had that same beat over and and over again. It just followed the same pattern until it ended.
See, I don't think it was that same pattern the whole time because, you know.
You also had Matt Damon.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Right. We'll get to that. We'll get to Matt Damon. But Anne Hathaway, remember, like, they were deciding at one point between which planet to go to. Mm-hmm. So are we going to the planet
When she launched into the speech about love out of nowhere.
Right, but they didn't go there. They didn't go for the love. They went for science. They went to the planet that was the more likely one.
And they went to the part that absolutely destroyed the movie. How, in what universe, in what dimension does Topher Grace give a better performance than Matt Damon in a movie? Like, That Matt Damon scene, like, I'm surprised he didn't, like, start twirling his mustache.
Like, what's it, I mean, it's a fair question. Was that a distraction?
Oh, my God, it was.
Did we need Matt Damon to be the guy? It almost felt like when the thing was opening, you're like, who's he going to cast? And then even I was like, whoa.
I actually would have rather. Matt Damon? I would have rather had an unknown person, so it's not distracting you from the story.
No, I thought first it was like, oh, cool, Matt Damon's going to save this movie. And it was like, nope, he's given the worst performance of his career.
What distracted me is that this is a movie that deals with these big, highfalutin questions about our place in the universe, and the evil guy who's all in it for himself, his name is Man. Like, oh God, what a good, what a subtle metaphor. Man, you know, is the evil one.
I like Christopher Nolan. I really like Christopher Nolan. I think the problem with Christopher Nolan in his last couple of movies is, and this happens with a lot of directors, it's he's done so good and he's made such incredible things, no one's giving him notes.
Yeah, not anymore. After Interstellar?
Yeah, after Interstellar. No, after good, Inception. Good note. After The Dark Knight Rises. Yeah. No one's like, hey man, maybe we figure out the movie. I know that's cool. Or, hey, maybe we don't need this Matt Damon thing. Maybe.
Roger, what do you think of that? Is that a fair statement? Do we think he's too big to get notes now?
No. Actually, I don't think he's too big to get notes, but I also trust Christopher Nolan because he has that ambition. He will do things that no one else will try.
I completely agree. True. He will actually do that. But and the thing with Inception
Let him fail sometimes. Let him have mistakes in movies and
totally.
Stuff. Because he's still going to bring us these movies that no one else is making.
I think we're all still fans.
I'd rather see that.
No, that is true. I mean,
I'll take a chance with any Christopher Nolan movie.
No, that's fair. Like, one. I want to see, I'll go to see the next one. And, like, and he did it with Inception. Like, he took the big ambition and then made a coherent story. But that's all I'm looking for. Like, it was just, I couldn't enjoy the vistas and the visual effects because I was so distracted. I was like, okay. I know I'm a dummy, but, okay, the ghost is obviously going to be McConaughey in a minute. Yeah, we're going to see that coming. Oh, it's going to take us 2 hours to get there.
But speaking
I'm
of people,
impressed you admitted you're a dummy, so.
Oh, yeah.
Point for that.
Oh, I'm the biggest dummy. I'm, yeah.
But speaking of people who don't get notes anymore, Hans Zimmer, like, I know
people
like this score, and it sounded like he fell asleep on a pipe organ. It was just wah,
see, but that wah. that's why you want to see in the theater, because like you felt like you were in that ship with them as they're going.
Yeah, like
up.
I couldn't hear what they were saying because I was in the ship next to them. There was dialogue
you could absolutely hear, but no, it's just this. You felt your actual seat rattling, which was awesome.
That's a point, and, actually. Some have said the sound mix is not good. Like you couldn't hear dialogue. Did anyone else have that experience?
Yeah, I saw in the same theater where I saw Gravity that was loud but coherent.
I know. I remember Jermaine Lachey on Splash wrote a good article, broke it down. Like there have been several complaints that he just doesn't. That Nolan's sound mix was off.
See,
that,
I like. I mean,
because probably Nolan was like, "Hey, no one can hear it," but he's like, "No, I'll just."
Which he did in the beginning of Dark Knight Rises.
Well,
too,
with Bane and all that. Yeah, of course. But
does he have bad hearing?
I don't think we need to get into that. Let the worst people get into that.
I mean, Nolan is pretty anal about his movies as it is and stuff. So I mean, he is like a stickler for detail. There's an article online about him. Like it was like 1 point off on like the saturation or something, and no one else was seeing it but him. And then the next day they checked their systems and they were like, oh yeah, it actually was this one. Like it's just like ridiculous attention to detail it is, and I love that about
him. Can we have one sci-fi movie in space where we don't have a dramatic docking sequence? Can we just have one, like, where like one movie has just like, hey, we docked, everything's fine, cool, let's go and do the thing, instead of like, hey, here's a 10-minute like waste of time that we can use to build false drama.
Look, don't talk about false drama. When that thing blew up on Matt Damon, that like caught everybody's by surprise. I mean, whole theater went,
holy
shit.
Yeah, because you'd think Matt Damon would know, as an astronaut, that you can't open an airlock.
Also, I believe
but Matt Damon has also been there for a long time, and he kind of lost his mind. And
also,
isn't he the best of them? This is not like a healthy astronaut. This is a guy who's gone insane,
isn't
basically.
He quoted as being the best of all of them?
Yes.
Yeah, but then they were saying he's obviously not.
So, I mean, I want to... Roger, kudos, you're doing great, because I'll be honest, I didn't love the film.
No, I know, and I'm in the minority here. I understand.
But I'm giving you major props, because I feel like you're defending it fairly, and it's good. But what I guess I'm stuck is, like, did you not roll your eyes when he fell and ejected into the black hole and saw his, and then they connected everything? It didn't feel Shyamalan to you? Like, I just want to hear a little... Like, tell me why I should forgive that moment. Because to me,
hold on, Nick.
That moment to me was really tough as a viewer. I'm like, I was invested, and then he did that. Like, tell me.
I mean, they established it early in the film. Like, you know, she's in that room early on and stuff. It's not like something that they're just like, oh, let's just throw this in at the end. It's something that they built up to and all. And I understand, you know, it's mushy love stuff and all that, and a lot of people aren't going to... be into that, but I thought it worked. I actually thought it worked for
the
movie.
I'm into it. I just don't... I'm not... like, this movie says love is the answer to all of our scientific questions, and it can cross time and space, which is fine, but I don't think the movie earned that. Like, they didn't set up a good love story outside of McConaughey saying, I miss Murph.
And that was
the only connection you had.
But you also brought up the point... He also ignored his son completely.
See, he did not give a shit about his son.
The son is the one... That's the character I thought was underdeveloped. But him and Murph, I mean, that was like the whole first 30, 40 minutes of the movie and stuff. They're down there. They're going to find NASA and all that stuff.
It's just one note, though. He misses her.
Yeah.
That's...
I mean, you saw that emotional scene on the bed where it's like, don't make me leave like this. I mean,
the one scene I liked was when so much time passed when they were down on that planet and then he came back, and that was emotional. Right. But you mentioned Shyamalan. So I'd like to really drive home, because that's an amazing comparison, because this is a movie about... This is a movie about an all-American farming family, science, where nature is trying to kill us.
Happening.
The happening. It's full of scientific-sounding exposition and space exploration after Earth. And there's a twist ending, Sixth Sense.
Well, let's not forget, he also wrote this for his daughter, Lady in the Water.
Nolan has gone full Shyamalan, look, you're drinking the Kool-Aid if you think that this is a good Nolan movie. It's like a mixed movie, but it's not
a great,
good for him.
It's a great Nolan movie. And if you want to know the only problem I really had with the movie, I hated the helper robot thing. It was like a
domino.
That's the
one part
I liked. That's the only character that had like a character.
What the hell?
That's the only person that had a character.
We cannot agree on this.
Why didn't she like the robot? I'm curious.
It just seemed like so clunky and bulky. It looked like something that would have trouble, you know, working its way into a staircase, or like, let's go into a...
Matt Damon was great.
I'm not saying Matt Damon was like amazing or anything, but look, like, say they're on this foreign planet and they need to go like down into a cave or something like that to explore, and so that thing's not going to fit in there. It's like this big clunky
thing.
It seemed
like he could do anything, though. He could turn his body into anything.
He could
try,
but
he
can't like compact or anything.
But did you
like
the percentage honesty, percentage com?
I did like that. Yeah. I liked like the programming of the robot and how they could adjust that. That was cool.
I think that's how Nolan directs people. Is like, no, I need you to be 10% more.
When he's rolling out the water, holding in halfway.
I just felt like they could have made a robot that looked like something that you'd connect with a little bit more emotionally.
But that was funny, because you actually did connect with him and you didn't connect
with
any
other
character.
That's you, but not me.
McConaughey was in it was a parody of Jim Carrey doing a parody of Matthew McConaughey. He was in full...
Look, you wanted...
We used to go to the stars.
I think Nolan's...
No. They were down in the dirt.
Here's my worry about Nolan right now, going forward. And I'm a huge fan, is I don't think he cares about the actors right now. I think he cares about the visuals. I think he cares about, like, what's going on, like, what mind-blowing thing are we going to do? And the actors are like, obviously, because no one really gave a great performance. McConaughey gave
a great performance.
But he was a McConaughey parody.
Yeah, he went full McConaughey.
What did you want, like, Russ Cole in space?
there was a lot more solidity to Russ Cole than there was
to
Farmer.
Listen, y'all, we're approaching this black hole in space.
Yeah, exactly. I feel like
you're losing your point.
Time is a flat circle.
Yes.
Hey, guys, love is important. Love is important, and I want to get to my husband or, like, boyfriend, because love is important, and I'm just going to shove that in everyone's face.
Yeah.
We could talk the whole hour on this, I think.
Oh,
and I'm sure some fans probably want us to, but we have a lot more fun topics I want to get to, so I'm trying to rein this in. This is tough. And Dan, since you're on the couch, I know you didn't like the film either,
another
right?
person who doesn't like it.
This movie was a mess. And my short thing I'll say about this is I think that this movie is a great compass for where your artistic sensibilities lie, because I feel like if you're more of somebody that's into spectacle and into kind of big picture things, I think you're going to like this a lot more. I feel like we are, number one, I think one of the reasons we work well together is because we kind of are trained, because about his trailers, to like break things down logically. And I think if you put this film to a logic test,
you're gonna
and just like
with Honest Trailers.
Does this, but you know,
oh,
like,
I can't wait for the Honest
Trailers. Take away the spectacle. Does this movie pass the logic test as far as things just making any kind of sense?
Yeah.
No. It's a
but hey guys, Fast and the Furious is awesome.
Yeah, it's everywhere.
Fast and the Furious
isn't trying to be a modern meditation on love and
it's
human
not like
kind.
All it's trying to say is cars are awesome.
I know. It's like,
I gotta call this in the middle, because I think I gotta give Roger props.
He really did.
You defended this well, and your McConaughey was spot on. I gotta give you a prop, but I can't just give you a prop. I think just Spencer made some really strong points. I think Nick yelled a lot.
So
I'm going to give Spencer and Roger points in that round. And we're going to say it was amazing, because it's a movie that I think you made a very valid point of, like, he's taking chances. He's out there spending money doing big things that even though I didn't like the movie, I will totally still see his next movie because right. I think we need more movies like that. We need people to take chances.
And, yeah, I mean, we'll talk more about Nolan, I'm sure, but
we're not representing.
And at the end of the day, it's time for round three.
Oh, okay. All right. Moving on.
So we are going to have to speed through this. That was a long round, but that was a worthy round, I think. Round three is a fan question from Joseph Canty on Twitter. He asked, Abrams, Fincher, Bay, Jackson, Nolan, Scorsese, Snyder, Spielberg, Tarantino, Whedon, best director in the world today? That's a big one. That's a tough ask.
None of those guys.
Fair question. A lot of people say Nolan. Maybe some of you guys will say Nolan. Let's start with you and Nick. Who do you think? Best director working today?
You go first.
What if I told you the man who made Predator and Die Hard and The Hunt for Red October and The Last Action Hero were the same guy?
Wait,
did we just get
did you lump you lump The Last Action Hero in with those other masterpieces?
Me on that one.
No, don't lie. John McTiernan, and granted, he's
Thomas Crown Affair too, right?
Well, Nolan made Interstellar, so we're everyone makes a shit movie.
Everyone's got the Interstellar.
I'm waiting for him to make a shit movie. It's not happened yet.
It just did. dummy. John McTiernan, who technically can still make movies even though he's on house arrest. Because he was
Dan, can you check that up? Can he legally make a movie while Nick's talking? I'd be curious.
I will check. Nick also Die Hard with a Vengeance.
He made Die Hard with a Vengeance too.
Yeah,
and
great movie.
He is a great director. He's made some bad movies, but the movies he's made, Predator, Die Hard, Last Action Hero. Granted, Last Action Hero
all
has
action
flaws.
Movies.
No, like great, all great, what?
He created genres. How many Predator ripoffs have there been? How many Die Hard ripoffs have there been?
He didn't create the action movie.
No, he defined it.
Okay.
He improved it.
Okay. Yeah, he made the best of them. And like the hunting for like the man on Predator, that's how many ripoffs have there been of that? The Die Hard.
Yeah, Countless, how many ripoffs?
Guy trapped in a thing.
Wait.
No, Last Action Hero. Now everything is it
he
was
didn't
the
make,
first.
He didn't make Cobra. That is one of the best action movies ever. That is the most macho movie I've ever seen.
It's not okay. I love Cobra.
Who did make Cobra?
Huh?
Who did
Dan.
Make Cobra?
Stallone. Okay. And by the way, Last Action Hero is not. I love it, but it's not
Me
for
too.
Everyone. But how many movies are meta now? He created the first meta, tongue-in-cheek action movie. Mm-hmm. He is the best of us.
All right, that's good.
I'm done.
Spencer, best director working today.
Still working today. I'm going to go with someone that wasn't on our on Joseph's tweet, but I'm going to go with Ridley Scott. And not only has he made a ton of good movies, but he's done them over a long, long career. In the 70s, we have Alien. In the 80s, Blade Runner. In the 90s, Thumb and Louise. In the 2000s, Gladiator, Hannibal, American Gangster, Black Hawk Down.
Then Counselor.
Yeah, well, we've all got a Counselor or two in there. And so I think he's just made awesome movies and over such a long time span. And they're not, they might not be getting better, but they're not getting worse.
Thelma and Louise was the best thing you could pull out of the 90s, though.
I love that movie.
that movie's really good. I like that
it's
movie.
A good movie, but I mean.
And it's different.
You're
it's
using
not
the
just
whole
the
decade,
same.
And that's like the one.
I will give you something. Yeah. He has variety.
He has variety.
He does have variety.
Black Hawk Down, he made Josh Hartnett into like a good leading man. That's
I'm more of a Tony
thing.
Scott guy.
Yeah. he's good too.
Rest in peace.
Yeah, RP. So he's good with actors. He's well-rounded, and my final point is that he didn't direct Prometheus. He didn't write Prometheus. He only directed it.
But
that's a good point.
Not everything is great.
Nick, like, hold on. Let's let Roger chime in, and then you can make your piece.
I did like Prometheus actually.
Nice.
The story definitely had some flaws in it, but it looked
it
great.
Looked great.
Yeah, absolutely.
Figures.
Yeah.
Who do you think best working director today?
Christopher Nolan, absolutely. I don't think there's anyone as ambitious as he is. I don't think there's anyone who makes audiences want to go see a movie in the theater. He's dedicated to film also. He cares so much about the quality. He's actually had meetings with a lot of directors trying to convince them just to actually shoot on film because it looks so much better and it brings you into the movie. He also uses a very, very small amount of special effects. He's all about practical effects, which I absolutely love.
That was a real wormhole, actually.
Yeah, that was a real wormhole. Yeah.
Really Saturn, too, right?
But actually, if you read up on what they did to make that wormhole and like just how...
He used a ton
like
of in-camera stuff.
I think it was like 100 hours of rendering time for each frame of the wormhole thing. It was just ridiculous.
So when he does the visual effect, he really does the visual effect.
Yeah, and I think they said like for as far as special effects, like his movies average like 500 to 600 special effects, which is really low. Like whereas something like other big blockbuster movies nowadays are like 1500 or more. So
I really admire that. And then just look at his body of work. I mean, you got Memento, The Prestige, the Dark Knight trilogy, Inception.
Yep.
It's just, the guy is
incredible.
It's
amazing. And we're all still Chris Nolan fans, even though we didn't like Interstellar. But when you see his movies.
Speak for yourself. I loved Interstellar.
you didn't like Interstellar.
Huh?
I loved it.
You did it.
I loved it! Okay, Interstellar's awesome!
Wow, he out-yelled you for a second there.
That was impressive.
But listen.
We're gonna get points for yelling.
Yes,
because I need to retabulate.
Yeah, don't start
we'll
yell
have
off.
A yelling match. Don't absolutely. Start a yell off. If you've seen my channel. All right. So look, Christopher Nolan makes you want to see these movies in the theater, and every time a movie of his comes out, it's a celebration. It is like you are excited to go to the theater and see it, and that
that's all the directors for us. I mean, that's all.
No other
directors.
Movie.
Let's challenge that. Does everyone want to see Exodus?
Yes, it looks awesome.
No,
he made Gladiator. I'm giving him a chance with Exodus.
Do you really? You really do want to see it?
Yeah, the plagues look awesome. Christian Bale as Moses. I mean, come on.
Okay. I thought
Ben Kingsley.
They could get someone from Egypt.
I'll see it.
You know they don't do
I'll,
that.
I'll see it, but it's again. That's way too much
time,
CGI.
I can't remember last time I went to see a Ridley Scott movie.
Okay, fair enough. That's personal preference, and this all comes down to personal preference. Yeah. But I would put in Scott's favor. You don't really know what you're going to get with him, whereas with Christopher Nolan, you're going to get a Chris Nolan movie, and with McTiernan, you're going to get a McTiernan movie.
No,
he has
McTiernan,
the most
you're
going to
get
three
no.
people we're talking
no,
about.
No, you're going to change how movies are made, and you're going to see. Like, and then everyone else is going to be like, oh, I want to make a McTiernan movie.
The only thing you know you're going to get with a Christopher Nolan movie is that it's going to be long. That's
here's
it.
Here's
that's
my,
it.
Here's
you
my
don't
problem.
Know what you're getting into with
here's
it.
Here's my problem
well,
with
Exodus,
Nolan.
Exodus is 3 hours long, too, I think, too.
I'm sure it is. Yeah, it's the whole Bible,
Nolan,
right? I've never
Nolan takes, he's a huge fan of film. Mm-hmm. But, and you can see that, because Inception was a really fancy James Bond. Yeah. You know, Dark Knight was, Heat, with Batman. So I feel like he's great, but, like, he's not creating, like, he uses a lot of templates, and then he just makes the fanciest version of the template. So, like, I think originality, he's just...
I didn't think Inception is, like, a fancy James Bond. That is...
Fancy
like,
Ocean's
if
Eleven.
If it's James Bond meets Nightmare on Elm Street or something, maybe.
I mean, that whole third act was, like, a James Bond movie. Like, I was like, oh, I want him to direct a James Bond movie. Mm.
That would be cool.
Yeah, I'm going to rein this one in, because this, I feel like you could, again, talk all day long about these, because it really does come down to preference, as Spencer said.
Andy,
but I think I have
some information that may be relevant
please,
to this argument.
Please, Dan, fact check us.
First of all, Cobra was made by George P. Cosmatos, who did Rainbow, First Blood Part 2, and Tombstone.
Oh, wow.
Oh,
yes.
He's not
Hero.
On our list, though.
But directly relevant to this, John McTiernan, at Last Report, is attached to direct a movie called Warbirds.
Okay.
It's an airplane dogfighting movie starring John Travolta with offers out to Queen Latifah and Johnny Knoxville.
Oh, all right.
Wow. And it's going to change the world.
Wow. That's the latest news I can hear.
You're
back.
He's technically a working director.
He's going through bankruptcy.
But he is a technical.
He needs work.
Nick
I think
is
that
not
he
disqualified.
Is
as a working director.
Director.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Good. It doesn't change my opinion. I think at the end of the day, Roger won me in that. I feel like the film, the practical effects, the calling out Thelma and Louise. That's a whole
you
decade.
You don't love that movie.
But it's the one movie you referenced
movie.
In the 90s. Like,
really?
That encompasses
still
the
40 90s. Years of good movies.
Good,
to be fair, Ridley Scott's other movies in the 90s, besides Thelma and Louise, were 1492, Conquest of Paradise,
White Squall,
and G.I. Jane. So,
White Squall!
Rough decade.
That's the one to call
Nolan
out.
Didn't make Predator.
But I think what ultimately won me is really the fact that I think we all would go see a Christopher Nolan movie.
Yeah.
And I think Ridley Scott's close. Probably the closest, sadly, out of McTiernan. If we're talking 90s, I think we all would go see a McTiernan movie. But today, I think the director that's going to pull the most of us into a theater is going to be Nolan, is why I'm deeming that. So Roger gets the point.
All right.
Good job. Let's move on to round four. Hope I'm probably mispronouncing your name. I apologize. Oyson Doyle on Twitter asks, it's what awesome. Is the best movie trilogy of all time? We're doing this because Chris Nolan did Interstellar, Dark Knight trilogies. A lot of people think is. A lot of people do. Maybe you guys don't. Let's talk about it. What is the best movie trilogy of all time? Spencer, why don't you lead us?
The boring answer is also the correct one. It's the Godfather trilogy. These are two of the best movies ever made.
And we're talking about a trilogy.
A trilogy. I knew that was coming. I'm aware. I know that's the point against it, is that the third one's terrible. But just think about how hard it is to make a perfect movie where you really can't say anything bad about it. The first one's the perfect mobster movie, and the second one's the perfect movie. So these are two of the top 20 movies of all time, and they're in the same trilogy. The third one could be Al Pacino's Dunkachino commercial from Jack and Jill on loop for 2.5 hours.
He loses the point. He's on Jack and Jill.
And it would still...
Yeah.
It
job to see Jack and Jill.
Yeah, I had to. And I would I would still say that this is the best movie trilogy, just on the strength of two perfect movies in the same trilogy.
Good fight. Roger, what do you think?
First off, I again, we're talking about a trilogy. You can't just be like, oh, well, the third movie sucked, and... the other two are great, so that makes it a great trilogy. No,
I just said exactly that.
A trilogy is three movies. I know, but you're trying to discredit the fact that the third movie sucked, and because the other two movies are so good, that makes it a good trilogy. No, a trilogy is three movies, and we're talking about the best trilogy, therefore the best three movies together.
Yeah,
so who are your best three?
I'm between two different trilogies, actually.
Pick one.
I'm between Evil Dead and Lord of the Rings, but if I have to go with like the best overall and just how much went into them, it's got to be the Lord of the Rings. And look, the Hobbit has really soured people on like the memory of just how good Lord of the Rings was. I mean, this was a worldwide phenomenon. The amount of work that went into crafting this impossible story that's just hard to even imagine putting into a film is impressive as it is. And I mean, we're talking about Peter Jackson, who... He had a background in like horror movies and stuff, Dead Alive and Bad Taste and stuff, and he's ramping up to a giant movie like that, and that's just amazing that he was able to pull that off after working on these relatively small films like Frighteners and all that.
I mean, it's really defined, I feel like, a generation of new films.
Oh, absolutely,
like,
absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I hate to use the word epic and all, like a lot of people will use, but I mean that's
we're
what
not
those movies.
Fine, we really use.
Good. That's what those movies were. And I mean, you know, look at all the details in the costumes and everything. I mean, they even did stuff to the costumes on the inner linings of their jackets, of the elves and everything, that was never seen on film, but just for the accuracy, wanted that.
And
they
had like, here's the problem.
They had like seven great endings, too. They just can't.
Nick, what do you think? What's your trilogy?
You said, Godfather can't be a good trilogy because the third movie was terrible. Mm-hmm. Okay, I say The Lord of the Rings can't be considered a great trilogy because... While The Return of the King, half of it was good, the other 90 minutes of the ending really took the movie down. I consider
it
90 minutes a movie.
It was not a 90-minute ending.
Felt like
it was a 90-minute ending.
Fact check. Why don't you fact check the ending?
That was a lot
there
of...
We go. Yeah.
Okay. Lord
I'm
of,
calling him out.
But I'm going with the original modern-day trilogy, Star Wars. All three movies are great. Yeah, Jedi's have the Ewoks. Go to hell. The Ewoks are fine. It has the most complete story. It has, like... The beginning,
Wait,
it feels
how does it have the most complete story? What do you mean? There was no resolution at the end of Lord of the Rings? Of course there was.
Yeah, but it took forever. Like,
that's your criteria?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah,
come on.
It took me out of it.
Again, it's not Fast and the Furious, man. I can't keep the attention.
Getting to that.
How dare you?
No. Star Wars is the original trilogy. It's the great trilogy. It's the most fun. It's like, you know, it's what got us all into film nerdom. Like, is we all became obsessed with those movies. We love those movies. It's why we're going to see it no matter what it's called. It's the best trilogy. It has the... And I'm just going off your criteria. It has... All three movies are great. Godfather 3 sucks. Return of the King. It's the sloppiest and the worst. I think from Star Wars to Empire to Jedi, they all have that, like, a quality through line throughout the entire thing.
And I think the same about The Lord of the Rings. And I also think it's kind of interesting that Star Wars and Lord of the Rings have this interesting similarity because all of their prequels suck.
No, well...
The Hobbit movies have been very underwhelming. They're not the worst in the world, and
they are just as bad as the prequels. So
here's what I want each of you to do. I want a one sentence on each movie in the trilogy. So you can tell me how they're separated movies. And we're going to start with you, Spencer.
Wait, well, how they're...
I think I already said it.
So
Godfather 1 is the best mobster movie ever.
No, tell
ever
me the plot.
Made.
Give me the movie. What is Godfather 1? What is Godfather 2? What is Godfather 3?
Godfather 1 is a mobster's rise to power and a son taking over for the father. Godfather 2 is that plus a commentary on the American dream and the failure and just... There's a lot going on in Godfather 2. Too much to put into one soundbite. because it's the perfect movie. And Godfather 3...
That's the failure as well.
...is a complete failure. Yeah, it's also a failure of the American dream in terms of cashing in. So it's like a meta point. Yeah, I'm going to go with that. But
Roger, can you break down the three installments of Lord of the Rings as separate movies?
Sure. The first Lord of the Rings, that's the one where they're being assigned this impossible task. And it's one of those things that you just climb on board with because it's impossible odds against these two little hobbits. And they have to go to Mordor and just... I mean, that's an insane task. So they're set out with that.
That is also the plot of the other two.
No. that's
two watts? I'm going to break it down. It's his chance to do it. Two towers.
That's a continuing plot. Two towers is basically all of them trying to defend this stronghold. I mean, that is the main scene in the two towers. It's humans and elves coming together like, all right, there's this greater evil in the universe that we have to come together and battle or we're doomed. So there's that. And then the third one is the conclusion of the story. This is the return of the king, of course. And
they don't really focus on.
No, they do. They do. Your 90-minute ending, right?
It's still Frodo.
And they have to call on actual supernatural forces, the undead.
Eagles.
The eagles. they have to call on the undead to help finish the task and all. But
Nick, your turn.
A hero finds himself in the universe, and creates starts a new journey, in A New Hope. Two, the bad guys win. For Empire. Three, the balance of good and evil is rectified. And the ultimate father-son story.
Pretty solid. These are both very traditional middle-end movies. Godfather says something about the human condition. None of these rise to like the level of art that I think that you can say that Godfather did. As much as I love Lord of the Rings and Star Wars, they're awesome.
So Spencer, if you were to pick Lord of the Rings or Star Wars, which would you pick?
Star Wars. I'd have to go Star Wars. I mean, it's personal preference because like you're either sold on Tolkien or not, and I'm looking back on it through the lens of being a gigantic Game of Thrones fan, and I just like Star Wars better.
And look, I like Lord of the Rings, but I want to win, so Star Wars.
Well, I'm gonna call it because I think, sadly, you're disqualified in my opinion, Spencer, because the third one sucked. And I think Roger gets a point it's close to getting the point for that. But ultimately, I give Nick a little bit bigger of a point just because I think Star Wars' movies feel a little bit more of their own movies, where I do struggle with Lord of the Rings is one long movie. Mm-hmm. It doesn't feel like three distinct movies to me. It's hard. I even was asking those questions, particularly to Lord of the Rings, because I wanted to, like, what really was the difference in two for the first and the third? So ultimately, at the end of the day, I'm going to give Nick a point.
They're definitely, yeah. I mean, those are the two best trilogies.
No. I earned that
one. Finally on the board.
I earned the McTiernan one, too.
All right, we got to go. We got to rush through
Is he on the board, or is he just out of negative?
He's acting. I didn't give him a negative. I was being polite.
Oh, fact
about
check.
25 minutes, by the way, Roger. That's about the length of the Lord of the Rings.
Thank you.
Oh, good.
Thank you.
Oh, wait, are we not?
I knew it wasn't 90 minutes.
Are we not going with the extended universe?
So I got to rush through this. It's not because we couldn't sit here all day and talk. And people ask, well, Andy, why do you keep rushing this? It's because someone else has to come in the studio and tape another show. So I got an hour. So sorry, I'm rushing through, but let's try and get through some of these other topics. Fast and the Furious 7, the trailer came out, the Furious 7.
Finally!
Yes. So the fight is, should Fast and the Furious end with number 7? What do we guys think? Paul Walker is in this film. It's his last major film. They used his brothers and his stunt double.
Hey,
stunt
some doubles.
Apparently they CGI'd him from the previous movie, so they had all that stuff in, and family has approved. So they were able to finish the movie with Paul Walker, which I think is kind of cool. I gotta say, it's a nice way out. I'm glad they didn't just shelve the movie. But do we think it should end after this? Is that it? Is the franchise done now that Paul Walker's gone? Do we want to see more of these movies? Do we care? We're gonna lead with Roger.
Look, Paul Walker, he was a great guy. He did wonderful charity work and all that. I totally respect him. I didn't think he was an amazing actor, but I couldn't care less about Fast and the Furious. Not only should they stop after this movie, they should retroactively erase all the other ones. Delete them from history. I hate The Fast and the Furious. It's just appealing to the lowest common denominator. It is Transformers. It is, Need for Speed. Yeah. It's Interstellar in your mind. There you go.
Nick, you got a response to that?
Yeah.
No.
No.
Oh, I need to do more?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. This is Fast and the Furious.
Let me lift your cap up so you can let the steam out. There you go.
I've never seen him with the hat off. Wow, that was strange. Yeah, that was,
no, you just see my brain.
Pure rage.
Lift it up, though. Your pretty eyes. So, no, you don't think Fast and the Furious should end after this movie?
No, because, okay, look. The first three movies were shit, but...
Whoa. Anyways, go on. It's your point.
But when Fast 5 came out, I'm sorry, it's the best action movie.
Come on, man. Tokyo Drift.
I still like Tokyo Drift.
I'll get to that.
Yeah. No, I think it's a fun, great franchise that's different than, like, what we have, and it's just... Like, look, I'm not comparing it to, like, any highbrow material, like, or a Nolan movie, but sometimes I just like to go to a movie and have fun. Look. And like, okay, the trailer coming out, The Rock is flexing out of a cast. They are flying a car into a sequence.
All right.
That's going to be the opening
sequence. Guess what?
This is going to be fun, and that's all I care about.
Guess what? That Rock flexing out of a cast, that's a bullshit ripoff. Because guess what? They did that in a Little Caesars commercial. A guy was in his cast, and he wanted to break out of it so he could reach in his pocket and pay the $5 for a pizza.
They're ripping off Little Caesars.
They're ripping off Little Caesars.
Exclusive.
Let us not recall that Fast Five is the movie that resurrected The Rock's acting career and now brought us the best action actor of our generation. The only one, to be perfectly honest.
Like,
Spencer, what do you think?
So, no, I think the series should not end with Seven, and please do not scare me like that. Fast and the Furious is not about the actors. It's not about
the newly
departed. It's not about Vin Diesel, and it's not about The Rock.
That's not true.
It's about the cars, and you can plug and play any cool action star into these awesome cars and have them drive around and blow up stuff, and it's going to be a Fast and the Furious.
Well, what about Need for Speed? That's all about the cars, too, right? I mean, come on.
No, here's the thing. I want to go further. I want spinoffs. I want Hobbs spinoff. I want Vin Diesel spinoffs. Then I want Infinity Fast Part 1, Part 2. I want more Fast movies.
I also, I won't go that far, but...
No, I want them to take the Marvel...
Is there one you don't like?
Here's the thing. They took...
Yeah, the first one.
Okay.
Look, in response to the Paul Walker point, though, Paul Walker has already been out of the series in Tokyo Drift. They had a different star, and it was still a fun Fast and the Furious movie. I get it. You either like them or you don't. I can turn my brain off and love the hell out of those movies. And they've already shown they can do it without Paul Walker. They can plug in Jason Statham. They can plug in The Rock. And it's still going to be awesome.
Who? I mean, they're just, like, have you watched them?
Yeah, yeah, and no, guess what? I feel like I've already watched Part 7, because if you see the trailer, they show, like, this dramatic moment. Paul, they're going off the cliff, and here comes Paul, jumping at the last time, grabbing onto the car. Great, I've seen that entire scene, and it's going to be completely underwhelming when I go to the theater and see it. Oh, wait, no, I'm not going to the theater, because I'm actually going to do something worthwhile with my time. That is a bullshit movie. All of them are. I'm sorry.
I have seen that scene before. That's a fair
right.
point.
And they're ripping off Little Caesars. I've seen the Little Caesars commercial.
You've never seen them drive cars out of a plane.
But
you've never seen that.
A million times.
Women dancing covered in gold.
I never saw that.
I know. Oh, great. I get to see another woman's crotch bending over as she waves the flag for the car race.
It's a formula.
I don't care.
I want to see a fight between Jason Statham and Vin Diesel and The Rock. There's a three-way fight. Also, Tony Jaa is going to be in it.
Oh, awesome.
I know, right?
Raid 2 is my favorite movie last year.
This is the Expendables. But good.
Was he in?
I gotta give Spencer and Nick the point because I think
what?
You both are making a valid thing of it's fun. It's but you turn your brain
but
off.
But I even proved that they ripped off Little Caesars. They ripped off Little Caesars.
You are a snob.
It's fun.
No,
it's,
I'm not. I love good action
and
movies.
I think
good
Nick,
80s action movies, like the director you're talking about, Cobra, Predator. That's awesome
this
action
is a throwback
movies.
To
this
those.
Is dumb.
I did not think Roger went out screaming Nick Mundy. I'm impressed.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
All right, let's bring it down.
I was on probation, so I can't scream.
But at the end of the day, I think it is. I said it. I didn't even mean to say it that time.
At the end of the day, Andy's
at the end of the day. I think it is fun, but it's also, I think they have reinvented it with the
last
three.
No, it's a great movie.
Three.
Each one is different. It's not just...
It's a heist movie, and then they've actually done... They've taken it beyond just the cars.
This is James Bond with cars.
They haven't taken it beyond the cars. For every Fast and the
Furious
movie.
These movies are America.
No, they're not.
Yes,
no. They're anti-America. For every Fast and the Furious movie that comes out...
I didn't think this would be the one.
For every Fast and the Furious movie that comes out... Good action movie gets buried.
What good action movie? There haven't been any.
Exactly, because Fast and the Furious movies keep coming out.
What's doing it? What other action movie do you want to say this is better than? What is it? I know it's not Cobra. It's not Die Hard. But this is a
I
best
want
we
more.
Can get. And the Rock is not
the
best thing.
We can get.
So you can go to hell.
You can go to hell. I'm gonna kill you today.
Okay.
Oh yeah.
Should we all just go? Should we
all
just
right.
leave?
All right. Wow.
Holy.
I got it.
You unleashed the beast.
You unleashed the beast. I don't
Spencer,
want
to
hear
I'm
it.
Taking away your point because I got Nick riled him up to a degree.
Holy shit.
Wow, Nick, you got the point on that one.
I know.
Kudos.
I'm sorry.
Spencer, you lost your point. Nick defended that to his death. I mean, that was incredible.
Be a good boy. Be a good
hey, do
boy.
You have anything to chime
round,
in?
Round six.
I have nothing to add to that.
All right.
All right.
Yeah, you say. You shut up.
All right.
Yeah, shut up.
Calm down. Everyone shut up. Round six. Totally new topic. This came in that they're campaigning for Andy Serkis on Dawn of the Planet of the Apes to be nominated for Best Supporting Actor for Caesar in Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. Should Andy Serkis or any motion capture actor, let's just put that out there, be nominated for a Best Actor Oscar? What do we think, guys? Is this allowed? Is this blasphemy? We're going to start with Nick. Hopefully you've calmed down. Nick, tell us.
Whew. Yeah. Sure. They can. But I think the thing is, people get so enamored with the technical difficulty of motion capture that they think it trumps other performances. And I've yet to see an Andy Serkis performance trump any actor. Like, just take this year. I love the Planet of the Apes movies. He's not going to be better than Miles Teller in Whiplash or Jake Gyllenhaal in Nightcrawler. Like, or the other... I mean, I'm sorry. I'm a little tired from that last one. he could, like, they shouldn't be disqualified just because it's motion capture. You just have to do as good of a job as an actor to win. You have to give one of the five best performances. I haven't seen that from him ever. He's great, though. But so that's,
yeah, it's a gimmick.
Spencer, yeah, go ahead.
I think no, unless they add, like, a best motion capture actor. That's fine. Give that to him every single year. But best actor? I mean, he's acting, but he also has an entire team of animators working on him, fixing any little imperfection he might have had with his performance. We don't know where Andy Serkis ends and where the animators begin.
Can I counter that? Can I counter?
Actually, we do. If you
we have
just
little
watch...
featurettes, yeah, and that's watch not the whole movie. But, and okay,
but you
on.
Can take computers now. I mean, like in post, like they can change eye lines now in post. They can change, oh, like cosmetics. I mean, you.
Oh, they can every... change more, and I have. A smoking gun that I brought with me. This is an interview with the director of animation on the Lord of the Rings trilogy. On the first movie, Andy's physical participation in the first film was non-existent. On the second movie, I directed an animator to have Gollum precede Sam out of the shot. This isn't digital makeup. This is a technical chore. This is an acting choice, and it wasn't Andy's idea, but mine. It's within my purview as animation director, and Peter signed off on it. He has a bunch more examples, but basically what it boils down to is even when we did reproduce Andy's expressions with perfect fidelity, Peter Jackson would direct the animators through 2, 3, 12 or more iterations with the animators working directly for the director, refining a performance in Andy's absence. We don't know what he did and what
Dan,
the animators
please,
did.
Dan, hold on, Dan. Can we vet that? Is that true?
I just want to vet, just for taking my opinion out of it, I just want to vet that saying that he wasn't a participant in the first movie is not a fair point because
right.
Gollum's not even really in the first movie.
Also,
you see fingers. So mm-hmm. That's a little out of bounds, I
that's
think.
15
okay.
years ago. That's also 15 years ago where the technology now is
right.
They can move eyelids and like breathing. I mean... I think that
that's what I was just
going to
say. That the technology has come way farther now. I mean, if you watch Cumberbatch in the Hobbit movies, you see him actually crawling around on the floor doing all this stuff.
I agree. It has come way farther, but you can always have the director say, "Yeah, I didn't like that. I wish he turned left instead of right." And the animators go, "Oh, okay."
They can do that now.
Okay.
They can do that now.
Right.
Like if we're in a movie and you give a bad eyeline, they can adjust your eyeball.
And look, nothing.
No, seriously, I'm serious. It takes a team of actors to like team of people to make any actor look good.
And nothing that he's doing, you know, necessarily with his body is changing what he's also doing with his voice. And I, you know, yeah,
you know who else uses their voice and body? Actual actors. They're using their voice and body.
All right. Well,
too.
Look. I am for him getting nominated. I am absolutely for it because what all these other actors have is they can actually interact with real things, real people, real objects and everything. Andy is having to actually use his mind and just imagine all this stuff. Imagine this world, create these amazing characters like Dalam.
No, you know who's having to...
No, we don't like Dalam. We don't like Dalam because he's not a real people.
Did he do the Caesar voice too? Did he make the Caesar grunts as well or is that something
They combined it with other voices.
He did do some of the other voice. I don't know if it was Caesar's grunts.
But
or
you know
or
who has to use their voice in mind? And imagination, the actors that have to look at this tiny British man in a body condom and be like, oh, that's a monkey, or oh, that's gone. That's acting.
Those actors also have a team of people helping them do stuff with wardrobe.
Not to the same extent.
No, it's still the same extent. It's like they have the same benefit, like benefits.
We don't know. Those featurettes don't prove it to me that they show you like 1/10 of the film he's in. There can be so many shots where they're like, well, and the animation director confirms it. He changed whole aspects of his performance.
Andy is an incredible actor with what he can do with absolutely nothing around him. He creates these characters. I don't care what the animators are doing.
Him and the animators
are coming up with it.
You're
throwing the animators under the bus.
He hasn't given a performance that deserves an Oscar yet.
I do think Gollum is. I mean, that is what most people remember from Lord of the Rings.
Do we? We don't think Caesar and Dawn is worthy.
It's great. It's not. I mean, but
I mean, was Koba better?
No,
they were all really good, and that just kind of proves the point that any like trained dancer could probably do a convincing.
But we're not talking about
even in the Hobbit movies, Gollum. I mean, that last one, that is what I take away from that movie. As far as like the greatest scene in the whole movie, because Gollum is just, he's hypnotic when you watch him. It is the one thing.
The animators
and Andy's performance working together.
So if he shares it with the animators, then fine.
And I'm being the most mature in this argument. I should win because I agree with both of you to a point. But there hasn't been a performance worthy of an Oscar yet.
I think he can be nominated. If he wins, great.
He could be nominated with his whole team of animators, and there should be an Oscar.
That's every actor.
Yeah, so that's where I'm getting divided too. Like where. We really think the actor is doing the work alone, and that's worth the Oscars.
He's
so let's say Andy Serkis goes up there. There shouldn't be a separate category is what I'm getting at.
No.
You think it's acting.
It's acting.
That's so messed up to throw all the people that spent hundreds of hours creating your face and changing your expression. Who knows? Like even changing your whole performance,
not do the dialogue and come up with the character that he has created. And that's it. They are animating stuff.
They co-created it. No.
But that's, I mean, film is such a collaborative thing anyway. Every actor, like they spend speeches just thanking all of those people. It's just not lip service.
Yeah,
I mean, so every actor has a team, okay? I have a team when
you can throw an incredible actor into a horrible movie, and you know, is it his fault that he was given bad dialogue? No.
But
he's still going to do his best job with it.
Spencer brings a good point to me when I'm trying to rule this because I want to also get to the next battle, but what if you can really change the performance and it's not his voice?
It like, is his voice.
Caesar is animals and it's sound work.
But they're changing the performances
now. Hold on. I'm just saying in that instance of let's try and make this winner based on Caesar. Let's just, because we could go.
I'm talking Gollum.
But if we talked Caesar, let's say, that's who they're campaigning for.
Mm-hmm.
He's not doing the voice. They've admitted they can change their performance. Does that bother you a little bit?
It has to, man. We don't know where Andy ends and Caesar begins in this case. So
in
you
Gollum,
can give it
I
to,
think you make a good point in that that was his voice.
That's
it was
what I'm saying.
Early.
I mean, that's what I think about. Like, I think he should be nominated for that. That's
so I'm
going to
give you both a point.
To be fair,
because I think
actually Andy Serkis did voice Caesar's talking.
It's just modulated hell.
I'm going to give it both you guys because I think it is a very as long as we are aware that the actor is giving the entire performance and we can sort of document it in a way that it wasn't cheated and the animators agree. Like,
you should share it with the
animators. We should be able to give that award to an actor.
You got the points?
However,
the animators
I'm giving Roger and Spencer the point.
There's a separate category for the animators and all that. The special
I think you
effects,
both make a point.
Effects,
so I think
so
the question of
they're
whether
they're already being nominated.
Whether the question of Caesar should, probably not, but should anybody is what the broad question was. I'm going to give to both you guys because I think you both made valid arguments.
All right.
Okay, let's move on to round 7. We may have to skip round 8. Let's see how this goes. This was a fan question based from Brian Ron Jabroni on Twitter, who asked, do we actually need Toy Story 4? This was just announced. This was hot news. John Lasseter loved the concept so much, he thought they'd never do another one. He loved it so much, he's coming to direct it himself. Do we need a Toy Story 4? Spencer.
No. No, we do not.
Roger.
Go ahead.
I don't care. It almost seems like all right, we're running out of ideas. Let's just try to get some more money.
Nick?
Yeah, because Pixar is desperate and they need a hit. Because the last hit has been Toy Story 3, and they had to push back the dinosaur movie, fire the director. I mean, and they're just going back to sequels. They haven't been able to get a new...
Well, to be fair, they have two new movies coming out next year.
Development hell. They had a fire director off one of them.
But they're doing two new sequels.
Toy Story 3
new...
took forever to do as well. Yeah, I mean, that was...
I'm just saying, like, it's...
Is that a negative, though, that they're being careful and making sure the movies are better?
No, but I just feel like there's been a downslide since Toy Story 3 with the last couple of movies, and...
Which was what? Brave and Cars 2?
And I think there's
Monsters U.
Monsters U. Yeah, that's three really bad movies.
Not great. Not Pixar. Well,
so finding, there's two new ones, then Finding Dory, I believe, is the one after
finding
that.
Finding Dory, then Incredibles 2, then Cars 3.
Yeah. Cars 3 as well?
Yeah.
It's like, make it, sure. I just feel, it feels desperate. And it feels like a desperation move.
Yeah.
Spencer, you only just said one word. I want to give you a little bit more.
Yeah, it's still no. I mean, and I just said the slate there. There are some originals sprinkled in, but this might, we might have lived through the golden age of Pixar. It might be over.
I mean, stories have to come to an end. You don't have to stretch things out. I mean, that's life. Things end, and you don't need to just release something just so you can merchandise it to hell, and that seems like what they're going to do.
That's what Toy Story 3 was all about. It's about death. It's about bringing things to a close, right. And it had the perfect ending. We don't need to jolt its corpse awake for more money.
I find it ironic that when Pixar was thinking about leaving Disney before Disney bought them, they were worried that Disney was just going to make shitty sequel after shitty sequel of their existing properties. Now that all they're making is sequel after sequel of their existing properties. They're doing exactly what they feared Disney was going to do.
Yep.
And then also, ironically, Disney is making, outside of Pixar, great is making movies. The better movies with Wreck-It Ralph and Big Hero 6 and
Frozen.
And, yeah.
I think it's unfair to call them dead, but I think you're making a good point that they should be worried. Golden Age, I'm going to give it to Spencer at the end of the day because I think you made that good point of we didn't need to reassess it right away. I'm even taking my opinion out of it because I am dying to see a new one because I have a kid who watches that movie over and over and over, and I cannot wait to watch a new one because I don't want to keep watching. Yes. And of that all the Pixar characters, I think there is a universe there that's great.
They might have completely new characters. It might be like grown-up, weird little Japanese novels.
Of all their movies, that feels like that one does have a world to go in, but...
But you're not worried about Pixar?
But no one made that
Has
argument,
Tom Hanks
so
been confirmed
I'm going to go with Spencer.
Four?
Yeah.
Okay, we are pretty much out of time, but I think we have 4 minutes till the new Bang Gang. So I'm going to rush through this one,
boom, boom,
even though I'm probably not allowed. So, but we're doing it fast. Round 8. Now, this is a tease, as we do every week, to an Honest Trailer. That means a Disney movie is happening this Tuesday's Honest Trailer. I'll just tell you, it's Maleficent.
Maleficent, yeah.
There's your good tease.
Maleficent.
So in honor of that, which was based on Sleeping Beauty, we thought we'd ask, what is the best Disney animated movie? Big Hero 6 opens this weekend. We're all, I think, excited about that one. What's the best Disney movie? Let's go through this fast. Roger.
I'm actually going to say Tron. Tron, that changed everything for me. First off, it's the first movie, it's the video game movie. That is your first video game movie. Oh, holy crap, we can actually use video games and make
That's
movies out of them?
That's not a plus to be a video game
no,
movie.
No, no, no. It is a plus because, I mean, you got movies like Nightmares, which is a horror anthology, and you had Emilio Estevez fighting an arcade machine
this is going
called,
back to your
called the Bishop of Battle, and that is an amazing,
deep
amazing
cuts.
Thing.
This yeah, is going back to your Interstellar argument where you're like, wow, this is cool, but it's actually just a bad movie.
No, Tron was a great movie.
I'm going with Lion King. It's Disney's action movie. It features the first gay couple in a Disney movie.
Timon and Pumbaa.
And it makes Matthew Broderick seem like a legitimate threat. So I'm going with Lion King.
Spencer.
I love Lion King. I do love Lion King, but that said, I'm not a big Disney fan. I was raised on Warner Brothers and Nickelodeon and stuff like that. So I feel like I'm going to go with Aladdin because that had all the elements of a good Disney movie. It had a really hot princess. It had amazing songs, but it also had the genie, which puts it over the top for me because he was like Bugs Bunny. He was the like chaotic Warner Brothers awesome like wild card that they put into a Disney movie, and that just puts it over the top for me. He improv most of his dialogue. Disney would never write something like that. R.I.P. Robin Williams, he was the best part.
If you want like pure just animated movie without any real people, I would have
follow
say
follow the rules.
I would have to say WALL-E because that movie took chances. You have 40 minutes basically in the beginning without any dialogue, and they're just relying on the art and just the story of this little robot going through his daily routines and everything, and they had enough confidence in that movie that would carry the
story.
But
it also had a second 40 minutes. And
also, it's too bad you went with Tron.
Sadly, I'm gonna cut to the chase since we have no time. I can't count as a Disney fan. I can't count Tron as an animated movie. And I think WALL-E's a fantastic Pixar movie. I don't think it's the best animated Disney movie. So I'm between Aladdin and Lion King. So I've already derailed you out. Sorry, Roger. Feel free to chime in if you have thoughts.
You mean
derezzed? Yes. So it's between Lion King and Aladdin.
Come on, I get a point for that.
Actually, made very strong points. I need one more point to declare the winner.
James Earl Jones.
Robin Williams.
Yeah. You said that one.
Okay, no, I got one more. Aladdin is based on Tom Cruise.
Oh, he got it. Nick did it because of the fastness. Wow, Nick, pull it out. 3 points this game.
That's pretty good.
Roger, you also got 3 points this game, but Spencer, you got 4 points
Ooh,
this game. Spencer is our winner.
All right. Hey, fans, put in your comments. Is it weird that the people who work for Screen Junkies always win? Question.
And I think we can pool our points together. Beat him.
Champion.
Yeah, there you go.
Oh, wow. Yeah, champion. You are allowed to do that, I
guess. Singularity. There we go.
That's fair. You guys yelled each other out of the competition.
You did,
Props to Roger for taking this very seriously.
We
You're welcome back. That's you did. Right. You took this very well. Thank you, Roger.
I kept the cussing down to a minimum.
I
want
to thank you all. Spencer first. Why don't you give us a plug?
Oh, Watch Honest Trailers. Watch. Oh, yeah. At Spencer J. Gilbert. Keep Watch Honest Trailers and Honest Game Trailers on Smosh Games.
Roger Barr, thank you so much for coming. Give us a go ahead, plug something you like.
You can follow me on Twitter. I'm at imockery. That's I-M-O-C-K. E-R-Y.
There it is.
And follow me on my YouTube channel. It's just youtube.com/Roger Barr. If you like me yelling, I just put up some new videos of me just screaming at everything in sight.
Can
and,
I do one of those with you?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Ready?
Oh, wow.
Okay, ready? Let's
Dick Funny
right
on Twitter?
No, let's do it right now.
If you want to hear Astros and left-wing rants, go to dickfunny.com.
Yeah!
And rock conversations.
Oh, yeah, if you want to see me and my friend hang out.
All right, I got to do some clean some business here. Thank you. If you're watching on YouTube, remember, we're also on iTunes, so go click there. Please rate and subscribe to that feed as well. Also,
Dan Cam.
Hey.
Oh, Dan Cam. Dan Merle. You're interrupting my ending.
Hey, as I said, if you're listening, Captain America.
If you're listening on iTunes, please do that. I thanked our panelists. I want to thank the Popcorn Talk Network. Again, I want to call some stuff out for them particularly. Again, like I said, we wouldn't be able to do that show without them. I got to thank Maria Menounos and that whole team on this side. They're in conjunction with the Schmoes. They have so much fun stuff on that channel that I want to make sure you guys are aware of and you're going to support, because we need them in order to keep doing this show. So Star Wars talk, movie talk, comic book talk, so much film conversations that I really want you to go check out their YouTube channel, youtube.com/Popcorn Talk Network. We're going to put a link in the description. Please go support those. Say hello. Tell them Screen Junkies sent you so we can keep doing what we're doing here. We're big fans. So thank you, everybody. I think we covered everything. Please tune in next Sunday and tell us, as always, in the comments and on Twitter, to any of our Twitters, what you want us to fight about, and hopefully you'll see it on the show. Thanks so much. Have a great weekend.
Guys. Thanks, guys. Thanks for listening. Bye.
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version. Lastly, please support our friends at the Schmoes Know Network for more awesome shows.